Thank you. Good morning, and I'd like to thank TEDxDetroit for the ability to speak. I'm their medical officer with the National Disaster Medical System, as well as emergency physician, and I have two goals this morning. One, to talk about what the NDMS is. It's a program that many do not know about until you have the need for it, and then two, talk about COVID-19. First off, I am a federal employee, at least intermittently, and therefore I have to display this disclaimer. The opinions I talk about are my own. They don't necessarily represent the federal government. The National Disaster Medical System is has several facets to it. One is a medical response teams to help communities in need medically during a disaster. What do we mean by a disaster? Disaster is usually described as when the needs exceed the resources, whatever those resources happen to be. So companies can have disasters, but communities can have disasters, and one of them being medical. The National Disaster Medical System has disaster medical assistance teams, veterinary teams, mortuary teams. I am part of Michigan One DMAT, which is a medical team. And I've been responding now for over 20 years as part of the system. As examples, when we go, we can either augment a hospital, help staff beds, which we've been doing a lot in the last year and a half with COVID-19. We can set up a base of operations outside the hospital or in a field or parking lot and see patients. We're sort of like a mini emergency department, but we don't have the OR behind us and inpatient beds. As examples, in the top left photograph is myself 20 years ago during World Trade Center 9/11. I didn't have any gray hair back then, do now, where we set up clinics and basically blown out buildings, is the way I describe it. That is one way we can provide care, and we're providing care to responders. The other two photographs show our base of operations, our BOO, where we set up tents, where we have everything we need. We have the tents, we have cots, we have medical equipment, medical supplies, we have the personnel, as well as medications, and as well as water purifiers and generators, so we can provide care in austere conditions. What does our team consist of? It varies. If we have a full deployment, it's going to include command and logistics staff. It will include paramedics, nurses, nurse practitioners, PAs, and physicians. And most of the physicians are actually emergency physicians, but not all. We have family practitioners. We have surgeons who participate. Deployments, the last one was Hurricane Katrina. I've also deployed to Hurricane Irma and Maria back in 2017. There, we provided augmentations in hospitals in Florida as well as Puerto Rico. Our way of transport, we are considered part in service in the military when we deploy, and we do use military assets, and we work with the military, and we work with the public health service. We went to Orlando using a C-17, the middle photograph. The two outside photographs show us deploying to a hospital in Puerto Rico with US Army Black Hawk helicopters. It's a really nice ride, I do have to say that. But we were packed like sardines between our personal gear as well as food and water, because we try not to be a drag on the local community. We try to bring all the resources we need in with the supply chain. So segueing from that, in the last year and a half, since February 2020, the NDMS system has been responding members, and we are intermittent federal employees, but we all leave our jobs or retirement for some to help others. It's a nice service that we do. In the last, I guess, a little over a year and a half, we have deployed as a system for COVID-19 as well as other events. We also do national specialty security events and the hurricanes this summer, there were teams deployed. But we've done a lot of augmentation of hospitals because of COVID-19. We've had the teams deployed to most states in the country. You go for 2 weeks, see patients, either backfill the emergency department to offload their load, or actually go onto the floors and ICUs and provide care and open up more beds for COVID patients. Because of that, and I feel very strongly about how do we protect ourselves from COVID. That is an extremely important thing. COVID is a pandemic worldwide. In the United States right now, we've had 45 million people, as a low estimate, who've had COVID. We've also had over 750,000 Americans, or actually people living in the United States, die of COVID, both at extremes of ages, most of it's in the older adult population, but still we see in kids. And about 200 kids have died of COVID. And the question is, how do we stop this? This is, to me, a very important question. In a Free Press article, That was like an emphasis 5 weeks ago, and also with CBS News, as well as many other physicians around the country pushing for vaccines. But there are several things we can do. But before I talk about the mitigation, let's talk a little bit about the character of COVID vaccines and natural immunity. This is data from the state of Oklahoma. If you look what's circled in red at the bottom, it shows the breakthrough infection rate for those who had COVID. Now, the data is somewhat limited. There are some issues with it. But you can see that number. And then in the blue is with vaccination, whether it be the mRNA vaccines, which are extremely elegant, or whether it's due to the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. This is US data. There's no other vaccines approved. The breakthrough rate with those who've had COVID is twice as high than those who got the vaccine. That's one issue. Second issue to think about is the duration of immunity. We know with the vaccines, especially with the Israeli data, that it starts decreasing at about 6 to 8 months. It's still protective, but not quite as protective as it was. There's data that seems to indicate that even natural immunity will wane based on analysis of SARS-CoV that occurred like 15 years ago, as well as other coronaviruses, which COVID-19 is. And so therefore, we're looking at an issue over the next few years at a minimum that COVID is going to come cycling around unless we get herd immunity. But herd immunity is not lasting if it's natural. Vaccines is our way out. Before then, we did masking as well as social distancing. They both work. There's data from Bangladesh, a randomized study that showed that masking decreased the incidence of COVID by 35%, which means you decrease hospitalizations, decreasing overload on hospitals, you decrease death. The data, University of Michigan presented data from schools in Michigan. They showed between schools that required masking versus those that did not require masking, again, a 35% reduction in transmission of COVID. Now, while most children will not have a serious case of COVID, some do, and I've seen that, it's one of the things that if they get COVID, they can pass it on to their parents. They can do a breakthrough case on their parents. I've seen that too. And those breakthrough cases, depending on their medical condition, that person could be mild or annoying, like losing a sense of smell and taste, to being a life threat. So it is important to mask. Social distancing works, but the biggest thing to talk about is vaccination. We have vaccinated people. Some people are concerned, well, the vaccine can hurt. I mean, for 1 or 2 days, you might have fevers, chills, a sore arm. I did. But that's minimal, and that's similar to a lot of other vaccines we have. Actually, the shingles vaccine knocked me more than COVID-19 did. The vaccine, though, long term, really doesn't do anything. Most vaccines, or all vaccines I know in humans, have not caused any long term problems. The vaccine has caused some myocarditis with inflammation of the heart muscle in some people in their lower 20s, and particularly males. But guess what? If you get COVID, you're 5 times as likely to get the myocarditis than if you get the vaccine. And in the vaccine, is the incidence of myocarditis, it's self-limiting. Patients might be hospitalized, but they get discharged and no worse for wear. So the vaccines have been very safe for the mRNA or messenger RNA. The Johnson & Johnson has had some issues with cerebral blood clots, and that's still very limited. But if you look on the public health perspective, we're trying to save deaths. As an example, a study published this summer from data as of May, they modeled COVID-19, the incident or death rate actually. And what they found is if they took into account vaccinations, their model predicted the death rate we see in the United States. When they removed the vaccinations, they found that an extra 140,000 people would die of COVID. So therefore, based on their model, COVID, the vaccines work. It saves lives without question. So in the end, I like to say vaccines work. They're effective. They're low risk. The smallpox vaccine is a lot riskier than what COVID is. Has killed people, but yet, because of the vaccine, we have no smallpox left in the world, except in 2 labs. Masking and social distancing work. It's very important. I would like to be able to work in the emergency department without a mask, but it's not going to happen until the incidence of COVID drops drastically, or I quit, or retire. And finally, talking about the NMS system, this system is there to help the communities. And they are responding now. There are teams out in the field. And right now, as long as COVID's there and significant, we're probably going to have teams out. Thank you very much.